to the church at West Franklin. Thanks for joining us this Easter.
We want to take this moment to let you know a little bit about our church family.
We're a church made of 9 campuses across Middle Tennessee.
We're united by one common mission.
Engaging the whole person
with the whole gospel
of Jesus Christ.
Anywhere.
Anytime.
With anybody.
This is a big day for us
because we're celebrating the resurrection
of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
His victory over death offers us a powerful message.
That there is hope beyond death.
Because those who believe in him
have the promise of eternal life.
If you're here for the first time, we would love for you to get involved.
We have a thriving preschool and kids ministry.
A student ministry where students can connect to God and each other.
Adult small groups where adults study the Bible together.
And learn to share their faith.
And missions opportunities.
To serve our neighbors and the nations.
There's a place for you here at the church at West Franklin. So thanks for joining us and happy Easter.
Well, good morning. Morning and happy Easter. Would you stand with me? We have a song to sing this morning.
Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives. God sent his son. To buy my pardon and
listen to the giver of life. With you give life,
you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart.
Amen. Amen. God be praised. Thank you for singing. Please be seated.
Well, good morning. He is risen. Yes, 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 yes. Welcome to Easter at West Franklin. Every Sunday, I love worshiping with you, but there's something about Easter Sunday morning, and I am so glad that you've come to worship the resurrected King Jesus with us today. Many of you are come on a regular basis, and you know this, but if this is your first time to the Church of West Franklin, I want to say a special welcome to you and invite you, if you're interested in knowing more about our church, you can take your device, text the word bulletin to 623-623, and after a couple of prompts, you'll be able to get some information delivered straight to your device. And like I say, if you're interested in a church home, I'd encourage you to do that. Also, when you walked in this morning, hopefully you received a flyer that looks a lot like this. This also has some things going on. For those of you wondering about more about this church, is anything happening, what's happening in the days ahead, I would encourage you to take a look at that just so you can be in the know. These things are for you, to encourage you and hopefully give you some information that you need. When you came in and sat down, you either sat down on top of or next to a connection card. And if you're a regular at West Franklin, you'll know this is kind of different for us, but we're going to ask everyone in the room to fill this out for us today. I've asked all three services to do it. Whether this is your first time at West Franklin or whether you've been a member here longer than I've been alive, I want to encourage you to please take this connection card out and fill it out for us. It asks for your name, phone number, email, and a couple of things there that may or may not apply to you. You may want to go ahead and check those boxes now. You can check some now, and maybe something will come up later on in the service that you'll want to check later on. Also, if there's nothing that applies to you and you just want to give us your name and a prayer request, there is a space there on the back for you to give us something that perhaps is on your heart that you would like for us to pray for you about. Myself, along with my staff team, it would be our honor and joy to pray specifically for you in the coming days and weeks. After when the service is over, under the exit signs, there are some, I almost said Easter baskets. I mean, it is Easter, and there are some brown baskets there for you to place these connection cards in. Easter baskets, place it in there. That would be fantastic. On the other side of the basket, on the other side of the door from the baskets are our white offering, our white giving boxes. Perhaps you came with a tithe or offering this morning. I would encourage you on your way out, if you could just place it in that box, that'd be great. And of course, there are also other ways to give of your tithes and offerings this morning or anytime. There on the screen, you can see that, ways to do it online, so forth and so on. Well, I've said all morning long, perhaps you have too, He is risen. And we are here because today is the day the Lord has made. Let's rejoice and be glad in it. And today of all days, rejoice, because we celebrate the fact that our King, who promised to rise from the dead, kept his promise, came out of the tomb, offering salvation and love for all who'd receive it. So I'm thrilled that you're here to help us celebrate that. Let me ask you now to rise from your seat and to shake hands or say hey or hug a neck or say He is risen to somebody around you.
Seated on the throne.
God be praised. Please be seated.
In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Without form and empty, darkness was over the surface of the deep. The Spirit of God hovered over this boundless expanse, a limitless vast of holy waiting, creation on the verge of dawn, heaven pressing into earth. Let there be. God delighted, revealing, cradling dust and dirt, he breathed life into being. From the beginning, God desired to entwine human and divine, setting our mortal hearts with eternal longing. He called us his own as we walked in the garden, leaving his throne for the mud and the clay. Our deepest shame, our darkest fears, could not hinder heaven's appearance. So his Spirit hovered over a quiet womb, the Father's seed in bloom, hope infusing the weary world. God making his way humble, coming beside us as we stumble through a light that shines in the dark that cannot be conquered. Let there be. And so it began. The Son of God and Son of Man offered himself as the way of salvation. Jesus, man of sorrows, the Son of suffering.
Oh, the perfect Son of God, in all his innocence, you're walking in the dirt with you and me. He knows what living is, he's acquainted with our grief. A man of sorrow, son of suffering. To the sinner you were grace, and the broken you embraced, and in the end the proof is in yours. Yes, in the end the proof is in your words. Blood and tears, how can
fullness of God in human form revealed, made his dwelling among us, the covenant was sealed. Now look at him upon the cross. Knowing the cost, still love inclined him to reach down and write in the dust our freedom from death and shame. With no condemnation, he proclaimed, "Go now and leave your life of sin." Jesus carried our sorrow. He knows our pain, our transgressions redeemed on that rugged tree, his death, our life and liberty. As he gave up his spirit, the earth trembled in awe, creation groaning, knowing surely this was the Son of God. Is it finished? Waiting for dawn, the earth paused in witness. Then the rocks cried out their hallowed response. Creation, inspired by the breath of God, cracked with the brilliant light of eternity. Let there be. Christ in glory, trampling death by death, rising in victory, who was and is to come, the Son of God and Son of Man, who was and is to come. and Lord of Lords.
Your cross, my freedom, your stripes, my healing, all praise, King Jesus. Glory to God in heaven, your word still speaking, your love still reaching, all praise, King Jesus. Glory to God forever. Blood and tears, how can it be? There's a God who weeps, there's a God who bleeds. Oh, praise the one who would reach for me.
Let me invite you to continue worshiping the Lord and turning in your Bibles to Luke chapter 24 if you have a copy available. While you're doing that, can we just give God praise for our musicians and choir? They just did a fantastic job. All three services just led me to worship very deeply and richly. I'm just very, very grateful for them. We're going to be looking at the first 16 verses of Luke's version of the first Easter Sunday in just a moment. If you've been with us, you know that we've been going through the Bible chronologically. We've been reading it as a congregation this year. We finished up Ruth yesterday, and tomorrow, God willing, depending on where you are, we'll start 1 Samuel. But we're going to be taking a break from it today. We've been preaching the passages that coincide with it, and today we're going to take a break from that. We'll be picking up next week. I mentioned that one because just as a reminder to you that attend West Franklin on a regular basis, but two, if you are looking for a church home and you want to know what's going on now, we are reading through the Bible, but 1 Samuel is a great book to pick up in and start, and so it's a great place, great time, so just an FYI to you about that. All right, but today our attention is here in Luke chapter 24, and I'm going to begin reading I'm going to read all 16 verses, the first 16 verses of this chapter, and I'm going to ask if you would stand in honor with me, in honor of God's word. Stand with me in honor of God's word. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they came to the tomb, bringing the spices they had prepared. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb. They went in, but did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were perplexed about this, suddenly two men stood by them in dazzling clothes. So the women were terrified and bowed down to the ground. "Why are you looking for the living among the dead?" he asked them. "He is not here, but he has risen. Remember how he spoke to you when he was still in Galilee, saying, 'It is necessary that the Son of Man be betrayed into the hands of sinful men, be crucified, and rise on the third day.'" And they remembered his words. Returning from the tomb, they reported all these things to the 11 and to all the rest. Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the other women with them were telling the apostles these things. But these words seemed like nonsense to them, and they did not believe the women. Peter, however, got up and ran to the tomb. When he stooped to look in, he saw only linen cloths. So he went away amazed at what had happened. Verse 13. Now that same day, two of them were on their way to a village called Emmaus, which was about 7 miles from Jerusalem. Together they were discussing everything that had taken place. And while they were discussing and arguing, Jesus himself came near and began to walk along with them. But they were prevented from recognizing him. Jesus, we've been singing to you and about you music, singing out loud verbally, and I thank you for that. You are the one who's worthy of all praise and honor and glory. But now I pray for the next few minutes as we look over the text together, this text of Scripture, that we would continue worshiping in our hearts. We're celebrating today because we believe you're alive, and so you are welcome to walk among us. Do with us as you please. And may we be found obedient and as a result full of life. It's in the name of Jesus I pray this. Amen. Thank you. You can be seated. Perplexed. Terrified. Ignorant. Forgot. Remembered. Foolishness. Joke. Amazed. I love the fact that Luke includes all these emotions in these first 16 verses. It's like he's inviting us along on something. All those emotions put together feels like a Monday morning sometimes. But it's interesting that he starts out perplexed, and then when Peter leaves the tomb, even though Peter didn't get it all quite yet, he was amazed. I love the fact that we go through all these emotions, but then when you're paying attention to what God may be doing in your presence, you leave amazed, if you're paying attention. As I mentioned earlier, we've been reading the Bible through this year, and it's fascinating to me, always has been, the fact that God asks questions. Why would you ask a question, God? I mean, you're God. You know everything. God does not ask questions because he doesn't know the answer. He usually asks questions, or he does ask questions, because we don't know the answer and he wants us to plunge a little deeper into it. He wants us to go from human way of thinking into supernatural way of thinking because our categories need to be adjusted. Remember in Genesis chapter 3, after Adam and Eve blew it and they went hiding and God went looking for them, what did God say? Where are you? Believe any of them said, we're right here. Very next chapter, Cain kills his brother Abel. God says to Cain, where's your brother? Dun, dun, dun. A chapter later in Exodus chapter 4, Moses is holding a staff and God says, what's that in your hand? You got to wonder if Moses wanted to be a smarty pants. A staff? I don't know. If you know the story of Elijah had a season where he struggled with mental illness and depression, went through this season, and twice during that season, God says, what are you doing here, Elijah? Not because God didn't know, God knew, God wanted Elijah to know why he was there. And in John's version of the first Easter, there were two women there that were crying at a cemetery, and the angels say, why are you crying? You got to wonder if the women were thinking, because we're at a cemetery. Why do you think we're crying? It's what you do. God doesn't ask questions because he doesn't know the answer. God asks questions to get down within us, to search, says, no, 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 you're thinking natural, you're thinking human, but God's doing something supernatural. There's different categories that need to be shattered for you to understand what's happening here. And I don't know if you caught it or not, but the angels asked these ladies, according to Luke, an amazing question. Ladies got up early, they brought their spices, they're wanting to honor this dead body that they knew as Jesus, whom they loved, who first Easter Sunday, no one was expecting a resurrection, and these angels show up, and what do they say? They ask the question, why are you looking for the living among the dead? Answer. They didn't answer, but my answer would be, we're not looking for the living. We're here for the dead. Yet God through the angels, why are you looking for the living among the dead? They were there 3 days ago. Perhaps they're thinking, we saw somebody put this dead body in a tomb. We know what dead bodies do. They stay dead. They don't move. We came to honor the dead on this Sunday morning. Why are you looking for the living among the dead? We're not looking for living. We're dwelling among the dead, not looking for the living. They didn't have their categories exploded yet. They were still thinking, resurrection, well, maybe one day down the line. But. And then the angels say, well, don't you remember what Jesus taught you? And I find it interesting the way Luke phrases it. Put your eyes back on verse 6 of Luke 24. The angels say to them, he is not here, but he is risen. Remember how he spoke to you when he was still in Galilee, saying, it is necessary that the Son of Man be betrayed into the hands of sinful men, be crucified, and rise on the third day. Now watch this, verse 8. And they remembered his words. Isn't that interesting the way Luke phrases it? Remember what he said. And then they say, and they remembered his words. They still are thinking of what he said, not what might actually happen. They're still not thinking a resurrection might actually take place. I mean, that's ridiculous. Nobody was expecting a resurrection that morning. Even Jesus' mom was not expecting a resurrection on the first Easter Sunday morning. Why are you looking for the living among the dead? Well, maybe the disciples, maybe they were just sleeping in that morning. They were just maybe going to get there a little later. They didn't get it either. Did you see what Luke tells us? The ladies take off and they go find the other 11. Not 12 anymore because Judas was no more. And the lady said, we went to the tomb. Jesus isn't there. We saw these angels, but it looked crazy. We don't know. And what did the disciples say? Well, he told you 3 days later we were coming later after brunch. Is that what they say? No. That's not what they say at all. They call them names. The disciples call these women names, say they're foolish. That's crazy talk. Resurrections don't happen. He was dead. We saw him die. He's not going to rise from the dead. That's foolish. What are you talking about, women? That's crazy. Be like one of my children saying, can I clean my room later today? That's crazy talk. That doesn't happen. Sorry. They ran to the disciples, and the disciples, and they had heard the same thing Jesus had taught. What? I mean, this is my 47th Easter. I've heard it every year. But that very first Easter morning, their category was not, he's going to rise from the dead, even though he said he would. Here's the thing. Why did the disciples miss it? Well, one, they had a wrong understanding of who the Messiah was going to be. They thought that Jesus was going to be a different kind of Messiah. We don't have time to unpack all that. I just know it was a different kind of dude they were looking for. But get this. They did believe in a resurrection. But they believed it was going to happen later. A good, pious Jew would believe in the great day of the Lord. A great resurrection when, at the end of time when God was going to restore all things. They did believe that. You know what they didn't believe? That God could do it now. They didn't have their categories. Why are you looking for the living among the dead? We're not looking for the living. We're here for the dead. And the angels are saying, you might want to pay attention. Let me ask you. How are you doing it? looking for the living among the dead things. I'm guessing you're here this morning because you believe Jesus died, rose again. Easter. I'm guessing you came this morning because you believe 2,000 years. There may be somebody still struggling with it, and that's fine. You can continue to struggle with it. I encourage you to struggle with it. But I'm guessing for the most of you in this room, you believe that 2,000 years ago, a guy named Jesus from Nazareth, a podunk town, lived a perfect life, died on the cross, was buried, and God raised him from the dead. I'm guessing that's why you're here this morning. And you're hoping that in a few minutes I'll wrap this up because before you left the house, you smelt the ham and the biscuits. That's what we do on Easter. You're here because you believe that. I'm also guessing that for the most part, you believe in a future resurrection that's going to take place. I'm guessing. May not understand. I don't understand how it's all going to go down. I'm not going to try to understand how it's all going to go down. And don't come ask me what I think about how it's all going to go down because I don't know. But I do believe that sometime in the future there's going to be this incredible resurrection and God's going to restore all things to the way it was intended to be. I believe that. And I'm guessing most of you in here do. You believe in the historical resurrection of Jesus and you believe that something's going to happen way down the line. But I got to ask you, do you believe that the resurrection Jesus might be present now? Is it possible that we miss the resurrected Christ walking among us because we think, I believe that, I know that's going to happen, but did you know that Jesus is here now? Do you believe that the resurrected Christ can just walk among you and be present and say, rise and give life? That's why I kept reading the verses in Luke 24. If you were to ask me what my all-time favorite chapter in the Bible is, I would say without a doubt, Luke chapter 24. I love it. So I stopped at verse 16 because I'm guessing you'd like to go home before May. I could talk about Luke 24 forever and ever. But I do find it very, very, very interesting what Luke tells us right after Peter left the tomb amazed. He said that there were these two guys. Don't know their names until later. He just tells us that there's two men and they're traveling from Jerusalem to Emmaus. And it's about a 7-mile road. And what are they doing? Well, they're talking about the events of the weekend. It'd been a kind of a crazy weekend. So they're discussing. And Luke even tells us that they're arguing. Isn't that fascinating? Two very ordinary, normal, common men walking an ordinary, normal, common road doing normal, ordinary, common things that men do, that all people do, have discussions and argue. In the middle of common, ordinary, normal stuff, who shows up? The resurrected Christ. And I wonder if we miss Christ because we're looking for this big laser show in the sky, or we're looking for him to do some supernatural, huge, big thing, which he could do if he wanted, but that's not where life is. Perhaps this Easter you need to pay attention to the dead things in your life and the resurrected Christ showing up to give you life. You do know, don't you, that only dead things can be resurrected. There can't be a resurrection unless there's a death. And I wonder sometimes if you and I are very, very guilty of believing the resurrection that happened 2,000 years ago, which is wonderful. I highly recommend it. And a resurrection that's going to happen in the future, which is wonderful, gives us a lot of hope. But we completely are oblivious to the fact that the resurrected Christ is walking in our midst. I think it happens all the time. A husband and wife in a heated argument again, just like before, fight, can't get any resolution. And then out of nowhere, there's this moment of love and forgiveness that we don't even know where it came from. Resurrection. Christ has come. It happens when you're talking to your children and they share something with you that you don't have categories for, and you don't know how to lead them, how to help them, and you're praying in the back of your head, what am I going to say? How can I offer something? And out of nowhere, the Spirit of God, the resurrected Christ, gives you wisdom, love, presence, and a word, resurrection. I believe the resurrected Christ meets us around the table with friends. I believe the resurrected Christ meets us in our cars along the road. Even though the last thing we want to think about is Jesus being in our car, we want the resurrected Christ to take all the cars away from us, far, far away, so we can get to our destination. I believe he meets us there. I believe the resurrected Christ is present with the precious woman who is needing all the energy she can think of to help her failing spouse who day after day after day gets worse. The resurrected Christ, there. I believe the resurrected Christ is there the moment you get the diagnosis and you don't know if you can make it. And then out of nowhere, hope, because the resurrected Christ has come. I believe the resurrected Christ was present this week in the days following the tragic collapse of the bridge in Baltimore, when my eyes saw on the television screen people helping people and people in Baltimore, Maryland, praying. Resurrected Christ ascending on destruction. And then we saw just a week ago where these people who were terrorized by terrorists in Moscow, and people that you and I will never see, shown on secular television, praying and helping one another. Resurrection Christ ascending in the moment. Are we guilty of believing that he came, knowing that he's going to rise again, but ignoring the resurrected Christ in our midst? You got anything dead in your life that you need the resurrected Christ to speak into? Don't ignore Easter. And it'll come in the most common, ordinary, out of the blue, the resurrected Christ will appear. And he will grant you life. When he came out of that tomb, West Franklin, everything changed. Everything changed. Why are you looking for the living among the dead? Or maybe, can I turn the question around just a minute? I'm going to, whether you say I can or not. Maybe your problem isn't you're looking for the living among the dead. Maybe you're busy looking for dead things to give you life. You've been guilty of going to those dead things thinking that they'll bring you a little bit more life. We're all guilty. This is Williamson County. Maybe just a little more money. Maybe just a little bit more and that'll do it. Yeah, that works. Maybe if you start making more, come back to me next year and see what you don't, see what you want. Maybe I have a bigger house. That'll do it. Yeah, if I have a bigger house, that'll bring me life, finally. No, it means you have more to clean. Maybe a new spouse, that'll bring me life. Maybe if I scroll one more time, I'll finally have that itch scratched. Maybe if I binge watch this show, that'll bring me life. Maybe if I bet on this horse or this game, then maybe that'll bring me life. Maybe if I just have a little bit more to drink, that'll bring me life. There may be times and places for some of these things that I just went through, but I'm here to tell you, the question the Spirit may be saying to you is, are you going to things that bring death to bring you life, hoping they'll bring you life, but really you know the answer. They just bring death. There's only one being that can bring you life, and that's the resurrected Jesus Christ. And when he walks among you, everything changes. I want to call your attention one more thing and then we're done. It's in verses 6 and 7 again. This is absolutely breathtaking if you think about it. Again, the angel saying to these women about Jesus, he is not here, but he is risen. Remember how he spoke to you when he was still in Galilee, saying, watch this, it is necessary that the Son of Man be betrayed into the hands of sinful men and be crucified and rise on the third day. Those three words, it is necessary, those are kind of a big deal. You know what that means? Is necessary. It means must, required, no other options. Jesus said it to them, and now the angels are quoting Jesus saying, remember, he said it's necessary, it's required, there's no other option. You want life? Then the Son of Man had to be betrayed. The Son of Man had to die. The Son of Man had to come back to life. That's what's necessary. Pay attention. Don't miss this. You miss this, you miss everything. Nothing else is necessary at the end of the day but this. What did you bring here in here this morning that was absolutely necessary? It is necessary that I get this job. It is necessary that I stay fit and be in shape. It's necessary that he get elected. It's necessary that he doesn't get elected, whoever. What's been necessary for you? Because my Bible says there's one thing necessary. In Church of West Franklin, that necessary thing has already happened. And if you want to know if you can make it through the rest of your life, know that the necessary thing has necessarily happened. God says, I love you this much. It's necessary that this happened. And it did. And you know what, West Franklin? Because it was necessary that he do it, means it's also necessary for you to know that you can't do it. It is necessary that you know you don't bring anything to the table. Don't go home today telling Jesus, look at me, I came to church for you. No, 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 no. You go home today saying, Jesus, you did it all for me. It is necessary he do it, not you. Now I'm going to ask the musicians to come back up. And as they do, I want to call your attention to this card one more time. If the connection card that I referenced earlier, there are some things on this card that may or may not apply to you, but I just want you to pay attention to what the resurrected Christ is leading you to, if that is anything here on this. Maybe there's some boxes here that, I'm interested in that. And would like somebody to follow up with you on one or more of these things. Please do. Or if there's nothing that on the front and you have a prayer request, let me encourage you to do that. And then place it in the baskets on the way out. But as they're getting settled, let me just say this. Maybe you came here today and you've never surrendered to the resurrected Christ. You came here today because grandmama said you can't eat at my table unless you come. That's okay, I'd have come too. And you've heard the story. You know Jesus died. God raised him from the dead. You've heard that before, but you never really perhaps thought that the resurrected Christ could actually summon you and say, come follow me. He can, and maybe today's that day for you. You say, well, what about my sin? Pastor, you don't know anything about me. You don't know what I've done. No, I don't, but I know my sin. And the reason I'm here celebrating is because Jesus came out of the tomb, which tells me that my sin was paid for on the cross. So is yours. Your sin problem, over. And you can trust Christ today and have new life with this resurrected rabbi I've been talking about. Maybe you know Jesus. You've been following Jesus for a while, but truth be known, you've been looking for dead things to give you life. And maybe you need to confess that to the Lord and say, I've been thinking that this is going to do it for me, Lord, but it's not. Only you satisfy. Or maybe you believe the resurrection that happened and you believe there's going to be a resurrection, but you've been kind of ignorant of the fact that the resurrected Christ has been walking among you. Never forget, only dead things can be resurrected. And Jesus is alive, bringing life even now. Jesus, thank you for your word. Thank you for coming out of the grave. Speak. May we listen, obey, and worship.
Nobody in the grave now. No enemy can hold you down. 'Cause there's nobody.
Happy Easter.